But tonight we are going to look at the unpardonable sin. And you know, the whole purpose of this Faith by Prophecy seminar and the reason why the La Center Church, the Minnesota Conference here, we want to go out into the communities and make ourselves available. It is something that we prayerfully do, not to exalt any human beings, but it's because our desire is to have all of us to have a closer walk with Jesus. That's the bottom line. To know something that's deeper, to have an understanding that we are saved by grace through faith. Amen? And that also we would have a deeper consecration of our lives to serving God as His ambassadors. And also to be ready for a second coming. So you may be asking, what do we do with what we learned? Or what do we do what we've had refreshed in our minds these last 4 weeks? Well, that's between you and God what you do with it. You don't have to live what you have learned from the Bible. You don't have to. It's your choice. And that's our freedoms that God has given us. But we also had the freedom of choice to say, Lord, yes, I want to do that. Lord, give me the strength. And I'll share with you, you see things clearly from the Bible. What you choose to do with it will affect not only this life, but also life eternal. And it not only affects you and those around you, it's also going to affect Jesus too. Sometimes we have things that hold us back. Yeah, and I experienced this in my early walk with the Lord, you know. Sometimes it's family members. Sometimes it's a job. Things of this world just have a way of holding us back from that full consecration to the Lord. Lord, no matter what it is, I want to follow it. You know, then you have something that comes up in the life that takes you away from that. Well, that's just an issue of priorities. And when I read my Bible, and I'm sure that when you read your Bible, you come to the same conclusion. Jesus should be the number one priority in our lives. Every decision we make should have in our mind, Jesus is the priority. And nothing else other than that. And you may have had some stirring moments these last 4 weeks. I know sometimes I get passionate on the things that I preach and share. I'm not very eloquent in talking. I stutter and I mispronounce words. But you know, the message, the Word of God, you know, maybe sometimes you all went home and couldn't fall asleep. Maybe something that was stirring in your heart, something that was brought to your attention that particular night that God revealed to you. And you're just laying there at night wondering, you know, you're just fighting back and forth with. Well, that's the great controversy. That's the Holy Spirit saying, let me teach you this, and let me guide you into this, and then the devil wants to take it away. And that's going to cause a stirring in our hearts, a stirring in our minds. You know, we hear it, and one thing I don't want, and I don't think Jesus wants this either, is for people to strive to live according to the Bible based on emotions only. You know, emotions plays a part in that, but emotions are like a roller coaster. You know, He wants us to be grounded in the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, that when the things come, we're not a roller coaster, that when things shake, we won't be moved. And so when you have that controversy, be prayerful about that. Be prayerful. Now, this message tonight, the unpardonable sin, is one of those presentations sometimes I get passionate about. So just hang on as we go through this presentation, but, you know, if the Holy Spirit stirs your heart about something tonight, you know, that's something that you might want to take between you and God, okay? And the unpardonable sin is also one of the more enjoyable studies you can actually have because it's actually a study about one of the Godhead. And I love the study about this one particular aspect of the Godhead, and I think it's going to be a blessing. But the unpardonable sin, is it murder? You know, the sin that cannot be forgiven, is it murder? Well, no, not necessarily. You know, the Bible says that, you know, reveals a lot about people that murdered, right? I mean, I have a picture there to remind us of Moses. Now, Moses was a murderer, wasn't he? And guess where Moses is tonight? Yeah, he said he's where we want to be. He's already there. Okay, so murder is not necessarily unpardonable sin. It could be, but not necessarily. So what about suicide? Or what about denying Christ? Well, Peter denied Christ how many times on the night of... Three times. And then on the day of Pentecost, we find Peter had a conversion experience. So it's not necessarily denying Christ, but it could be, but not necessarily. What about suicide? You know, that last thought in a person's mind before they take away that gift of life that God gave them and throwing it right back in God's face, is that the unpardonable sin? Well, we had the question about suicide the other night, and we went through that, and we looked at Samson and all that. That's the picture that we have up there. He pulled the temple of Dagon down on himself. So, no, it's not, but it could be. But let me say this. I said this the other night, and I need to say it again. If you know anybody and you have an opportunity to talk to somebody who is contemplating suicide, pray. Suicide is a very serious thing. And it's only recorded one place in the Bible that I know of somebody who committed suicide that's going to be in heaven, and that's Samson. That's to give the survivors hope. Okay? But it's a slim chance in that. So what is the unpardonable sin? Well, what we're going to do tonight, we're going to look at the steps that a person takes to receive the proclamation of the unpardonable sin. Because what we don't want to do, we don't want to take that first step, do we? So we're going to look and see what these steps are. I first want to start with this here. This is Jesus in Matthew 12, verse 30. Jesus says, "He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad." Now, what Jesus is telling us here, and we need to establish this first and foremost tonight, is that there's no fence riding in Christianity. You either or you're not. You with this? He says that you're either with me or you're not. You have to make a decision to be with Jesus. You're just not going to happen to make it to heaven. It has to be a decision that we make that we're going to strive for that. You follow that? Say amen. You see, Jesus is saying you can't sit on the fence because by default, Satan owns the fence. You see, you know, some people say, okay, well, you know, this group of people here, they're deciding to be on Satan's side. Well, if I just, you know, kind of ride in between and all that, and I don't really necessarily make a decision, in God's sight, that is making a decision. If we don't choose to be on Christ's side, we're not on Christ's side. It has to be proactive. Matthew 12, verse 31 and 32 says, "Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men." Why? Because if we confess our sins and repent of our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But, that little three-letter word, the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. But notice there it says all manner of sin. There's a contrast in this verse here. The word manner in this text means kind or type. The unpardonable sin is not a type of sin, or is not a kind of sin. So murder is a kind of sin, but it's not murder, but it could be, and I'll back that up. So let's move on here. We may be great sinners, but we have a what? A great Savior. We need to make this clear at the beginning of tonight as well. How many have sinned? Now let me make it more personal. Have you sinned? I have. I'm guilty. The Bible is filled with godly people, amen? And every one of them sinned. Everyone. Save Jesus, but everyone. So why does the Bible record the lives of sinners? And why should we study them? These godly people in God's Word that sin, but yet they are godly people, the Bible shows their lives of how a submissive heart to the Lord, God can change that heart. God can do something with that heart. How God has worked with these hearts of sinners. He can do the same thing for each one of us. Amen? We are sinners. Yet we have a great Savior. Amen. Amen. If we confess our sins, 1 John 1:9, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from how much unrighteousness? So here we have the blessing, but there's a condition attached to it. That's why that starts with that two-letter word, if. So there's a condition. Two verses before this gives us some more conditions. You know, salvation is a free gift, right? But yet the right to exercise it has conditions, right? And this is one of them here. Two verses before that says, but if we walk in the light, that's a condition. As He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. So we have to confess it, but we have to also walk it. Okay? So, it's something that's actually not just a hearer only, but a doer of the word. Matthew 12:32 says, and whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him, because we've confessed, we repent, we walk in the light. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. That's the unpardonable sin. It's not a sin, it's not sinning, blaspheming against the Father. It's not a sin against the Son. It's to sin against who? It's the Holy Spirit. The third part of the Godhead. We can only understand the unpardonable sin if we understand how the Holy Spirit has worked through the Bible. And Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and I am the Lord and I change. Now, you have God the Father. Does He change? You have God the Son, Jesus. Does He change? God the Holy Spirit. Does He change? No. So, however the Holy Spirit, and we study the Holy Spirit, and the Bible doesn't say all that much about the Holy Spirit, but the Bible does say something about the Holy Spirit. So, whatever we can study of the Holy Spirit in the Scripture and how that applied to people then, so it is with us today. If we allow the Holy Spirit to do that. Jesus says in John 16:7, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, did Jesus depart? He certainly did. I will send Him unto you. Now I want to point this out, and I haven't had it so much of a controversy here, but I have had it in the past. People say the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. You know, it's a thing. You know, it's like an invisible vapor spirit. It's not necessarily a person, you know, an entity of His own. But Jesus says the Holy Spirit is Him. 13 times, I think it is, in chapters 14 and 16, Jesus calls the Holy Spirit Him. Okay? Now look what it says here in Ephesians 4:30. Says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit. Now think about this. Can the Holy Spirit be grieved? We just read that, right? Amen? So if the Holy Spirit can be grieved, that means the Holy Spirit has feelings. If the Holy Spirit has feelings, that means the Holy Spirit has a mind. If the Holy Spirit has a mind, that means the Holy Spirit has a personality. If the Holy Spirit has a personality, that means the Holy Spirit is an individual. And if the Holy Spirit is an individual, that means He's not God the Father. He's not God the Son. He's God the Holy Spirit. Complete, individual, separate entity. And grieve not the Holy Spirit. Why do we not want to grieve Him? Because it's by the Holy Spirit that gives us the seal of God. See, if we grieve the Holy Spirit, and I catch this, this is important to understand. If we grieve the Holy Spirit in our decision-making, we will not receive the seal of God. And we saw the other night when we looked at the mark of the beast and the seal of God, and is it important to receive the seal of God? You better believe it is. If you don't receive the seal of God, guess where you're not going? So to receive the seal of God, who is it that gives it? The person of the Godhead we don't want to offend. Because when we offend that part of the Godhead, it's called the unpardonable sin. There's no forgiveness of it. You don't get the seal of God. Make that connection. Jesus says in John 16, 8, and when he, the Holy Spirit, is come, he, the Holy Spirit, will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Now, you can pretty much just take that verse right there and do a complete study of the Holy Spirit. Well, what we're going to do is I'm going to lay some foundations from the Bible about the Holy Spirit, how it applies to us and the workings with us. Then we're going to come back to this verse, and I want to bring it all together using this verse. So that's what we're going to do tonight. So the unpardonable sin occurs when any individual repeatedly says no to God. Repeatedly. The Bible talks about the searing of your conscience. You know, and whenever I read that, talking about the conscious seared with a hot iron, it says in the New Testament, I think of like when you go to a Home Depot or you go to a Lowe's and you got to buy rope, you know, and you buy that nylon type rope, you know, and then you have them cut it, and it's nice, nice straight cut, right? And it looks really nice until a few weeks after you use it, and it starts fraying on the end, doesn't it? So, I mean, I used to work at Home Depot, and when I'd cut the rope, we had a heater there, kind of like a hot iron. And what would we do with that hot iron? We would sear the end of it. What would that cause that end of that rope, that nylon rope, to do? Melt and harden. So when the Bible talks about that people's consciences are seared with a hot iron, it's talking about we have hardened our hearts to the working, the voice of God to us. When we have that heart of stone, and the Bible talks about, let God take out that heart of stone and put in a heart of what? Heart of flesh. Something that's not hard. So this unpardonable sin occurs when any individual repeatedly says no to God. I look at like, and I'll make this illustration here, like a brick wall. Okay? Say you guys there, out there, you're the Holy Spirit, and I'm the sinner here, okay? And I'm getting ready to do a sin that I know better because I've read it in the Bible. And you have you experienced that? You get ready to do something, and you know you're not supposed to do that. You know that's not what God wants you to do. And you're getting ready to do it, and you kind of hear that small, still voice. Don't do it, right? Have you? Or you have a verse comes to your mind as soon as you're getting ready to do something or something. That's the Holy Spirit talking to you. You know, and say I'm getting ready to do something, and the Holy Spirit says something, and the Holy Spirit's over there, and I'm here, and I say no to the Holy Spirit. Well, I just put a brick over there, right? And then I say no again. And each time I say no to God, it gets easier and easier. I'm searing my conscience. It's a process. And the harder I allow the end of that nylon rope to get, the easier it is to say no to God. And then another brick, and another brick, and another brick, and another brick, and another brick. And all of a sudden, there's one more brick to completely shut it off. See, the unpardonable sin is not the first brick. The unpardonable sin is the last brick. But we don't want to lay the first brick, do we? Not at all. We don't want to do that. The unpardonable sin is not a kind of sin. Is it murder? It could be. But not necessarily. Is it suicide? Is it denying Christ? No. It's not necessarily a kind of sin, but the degree which a person is in sin. You see, the more I say no to God on anything, it doesn't matter what it is. If it's something that's been revealed to me from God, this is God's will, and I keep saying no to it, I keep saying no. It's not God running from me. It's me running from God. And pretty soon, all that brick's all there. Or I'm going such a distance away from God. Or my heart's been seared so much that I don't hear him anymore. And it gets to the point where God says, there's no more we can do for this person. So he withdraws that Holy Spirit. We talked about this other night. God withdraws that Holy Spirit. Then what naturally fills that void? Lie. We'll look at that verse in a minute. So is it possible to tell whether or not a person has been filled with the Holy Spirit? You know, you have people, and again, I haven't had this much of experience of this here in Minnesota, but in other places, especially the Bible Belt, yeah. You know, can you speak in tongues? You know, well, that's the sign that you have the Holy Spirit. Can you speak in tongues? Well, the Bible tells me that speaking in tongues, the true gift of tongues, is a gift. Not the fruit. And they get that all mixed up. So is it possible to tell whether or not a person has been filled with the Spirit? How does the Bible define it? What do we look for? Well, first off, Jesus says this in Matthew 7:20, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. How are they living their lives? What are their decisions they're making? You know, we're not to judge each other, and I do want to talk about this. We're not to pass judgment, but we are to be fruit inspectors. Now, let me explain what I mean by that. Let me explain what the Bible means by that, okay, so we don't get confused. If I see somebody choosing not to follow the Word of God, and they know what it is they're saying no to, should I entrust my learning to that person? Or should I associate myself with that person on the basis where I will allow them to be an influence in my spiritual walk with Jesus? Or should I allow that person to take a leadership role in the church or whatever it may be? No, because by their fruits I know that. I don't want to do that. But I cannot pass judgment that person's loss because they may turn and repent next week. We're not to judge people's salvation, but we can be fruit inspectors. That's what Jesus is telling us to do. By their fruits you shall know them, by their deeds, by their decisions. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. It's not, we don't tell people that are filled with the Holy Spirit by them speaking in tongues. The fruit, notice that's not plural, singular. So if you have one without the other, you don't have the fruit. Now, we need to be growing and have these things established more in us. That's growing in grace. But the fruit of the Spirit is love. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll... So is it possible with somebody that is willingly not keeping the seventh-day Sabbath to have the Holy Spirit? I mean, some of these things are hard to grasp onto. Now, if it's some... And I do need to qualify that because that was a really strong statement I just said. Judge them by their fruits. Jesus says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Now, if a person is struggling with something, that's one thing. I'm just talking blatantly, you know, and I've come across them, believe me. Yes, it says that in there, but we don't have to do that. They're nailed to the cross. When Jesus himself says, if you love me, you'll do these things. You know, that's a sign. But the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy. I'll leave that one alone. And peace and long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, and on and on and on. This is the evidence of a Holy Spirit being in somebody's life. Understand that we live in a sinful world. Understand that we are affected by the sinful world. And we have our mood swings. You know, so keep in mind of that when we observe each other, but also keep in mind as well, as we're fruit inspectors, that we have an example that's perfect, and his name's Jesus. Okay, we can encourage each other, we can help each other, we can pray together, we can help each other through these things for a deeper understanding of things, but our perfect example is Jesus. But we can tell if somebody is at least going in the right direction. To be filled with the Holy Spirit means to have a heart that deeply loves Jesus. Amen? Amen? Amen. To have a mind filled with His Word. That means you're meditating. David says, I meditate on that Word all day long. Yeah. So we should be doing the same thing. We're meditating on the Word of God. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. To have a determination to follow the truth. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It's not hearers of the word only, but the doers. And we can't do it in our own strength. Ain't no way. Only through the power of Jesus. But Jesus isn't here. That's why he said it's expedient that I go away. That I go away so I can send the Holy Spirit to you. Jesus began a work in us, but it's not Jesus crawling in my heart to complete that work. It's Jesus completing the work in my heart through the Holy Spirit that dwells in me. Know ye not, ye are the temple of God, and the Holy Spirit dwelleth in you? So does the Holy Spirit fill those who deliberately break God's commandments? That's a good question. That's a serious question. Can the Holy Spirit? But let's rephrase this question, okay? Who is it that the Holy Spirit does fill? Well, Jesus says this in John 14, verse 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Do you know what verse 16 says? Verse 15 is, if you love me. Now, first thing is love. Has to be for the correct reason. We keep them not to be saved. We keep them because he loved us when we were yet sinners and still died on the cross to save us. And we have fallen in love with that sacrifice. Lord, what would you have us to do? Lord, what can I do to please you? We want to keep your commandments and those things that are pleasing in your sight. And Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, and then I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. Obedience is love, desire to follow God's will, and then the power of the Holy Spirit comes to help us with the desire to follow his will. That's the outline all through Scripture. And I will pray the Father, and he, the Father, shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but you know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. It's the Holy Spirit that works in us. It's Jesus working in us, but it's through the Holy Spirit. You have God the Father. Jesus glorifies the Father. And in return, the Father glorifies Jesus. But Jesus glorifies the Father, but the Holy Spirit glorifies Jesus. It's like a mini hierarchy in heaven. God the Father, then God the Son, then God the Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean one's more important. Doesn't mean one's more powerful. But they have a hierarchy within themselves. The Holy Spirit glorifies Jesus. Jesus glorifies the Father. Then the Father returns it back to Jesus. Jesus glorifies us when we glorify him. Everything's getting glorified if they're walking with the Lord. Amen? Jesus says through John, 1 John 2:3, and hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. Verse 4 says, he that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments. What about that fruit love? We talked about a moment ago. If they say, I know Jesus, and they are willfully not following the Bible, or any portion of the Bible, anything that God has said that we should do in our lives, and yet we say we know him, Jesus says we're a liar. And the truth, the Spirit of truth, is not in that person. Does that sound like that could possibly be walking down the road towards the unpardonable sin? Kind of setting some bricks down? So what is the main reason God fills his people with his Spirit? You know, what's the purpose of the Holy Spirit? Is it to babble in tongues? Is it to roll up and down the aisles? Is it to jump up and down and swing your arms and hoot and holler in church like a lot of churches do? Is that what the purpose of the Holy Spirit is? No. What's the Bible say? You'd be surprised how many people think it is. You would be surprised. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 says, but ye shall receive power. See, we can't do it in our power. When we choose to, or purpose in our heart, same thing, to purpose in our heart to follow and do it God's way, Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, then I will pray the Father to send the Holy Spirit to you. And when the Holy Spirit comes to us, he's bringing power for us. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Power to do what? Look what it says. And you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea, all of Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. When you study the Bible, and we're going to look at it tonight, two main purposes for the Holy Spirit to be with us. One is for our personal preparation. You with me on that? It gives us the power to live a holy life. But it also gives us power to do something else, which is number two, to share Jesus with other people. Look what it says here in Acts 4:31. And when they had prayed, speaking of the apostles, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. So they were coming together to pray, coming together to worship, where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Witnessing, preaching, teaching God's way. Amen? So how can I receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Now, let me explain this. This takes a little bit of explaining, and I worded that question that way for this very reason. The Bible talks about two different types of baptism. You have the baptism by the water and baptism of the Holy Spirit. Baptism of the water is basically our choice. You know, Jesus says, teach them, you know, go out in all the world, teach them, baptize them in the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and then continue teaching them all that I have commanded you. So once a person learns essentials and chooses to live by those essentials, then they're baptized by immersion into the remnant church. And then they learn more. But that person, they could put on a facade. You ever seen people like that? They look really good on the weekend, whether it's Sunday or Sabbath, when they go to church. But when you see them during the week, they're just like the heathen. You know, but they can fool. We can fool each other. And so a person may be baptized who's not truly converted, but it's the human choice. But God knows the heart. He's not going to send the Holy Spirit to somebody who was willfully disobedient. We just saw some of that, didn't we? So is the baptism of the Holy Spirit is sent, God chooses and sends that baptism to a person he can trust. You with me on that? Now let's get some scripture. And we are his witnesses of these things, Peter says in Acts chapter 5. And so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will give him to you. Pray the Father to give them to you. Obedience. We looked the other night when we looked at the prophet. We looked at how the law and the prophets go together. If you're not keeping the law, you don't get the gift. But who gave that gift? The Holy Spirit. Gifts of the Spirit, right? It's the same thing. Be obedient and you receive the gift of the Spirit. That's what Peter's saying there. And Luke says it here. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? Ye receive not because you... So here's where you claim the promises. You love Jesus enough to keep his commandments. You love Jesus enough to strive to do all those things that he has asked and outlined in his word. And you know, it's a struggle. Strive. We are to strive to be among a number. And as long as we're purposing our heart and we're making headway, we're allowing the Holy Spirit to work on us. When we stumble, we get back up and we're still shooting for that mark, shooting for the kingdom. We're running that race in the strength of Jesus through the Holy Spirit. And then we say, oh, but Lord, I need to have that Holy Spirit. I'm choosing that. Lord, I'm claiming the promise. I am living up to the light that you have given me thus far. Now, pour out your Holy Spirit on me. Right? That's how it works. I mean, if you think about that, if we're doing it God's way, can't we hold our Heavenly Father to his word? And tell him, Lord, I'm asking you, I have met your requirements. You think he'll do it? Is that asking according to his will? You better believe it is. So what is the primary work of the Holy Spirit? John 14, 26, Jesus says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall. You see, night after night, it's not me up here teaching. I'm just sharing with you what God said. And I expound a little bit on it. But all I'm doing is sharing with you what God has said. You know something? I'll share something with you. Any of you can do what I'm doing. Just, Lord, help me share Jesus. Isn't that what they said? Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in all these different places. Now, you may not be able to stand or not have a calling or whatever to stand up front in the crowd, but all I'm doing is teaching the Word of God, sharing what God has already said. You can do that. You're called to do that. But it's the Holy Spirit. Every night, Bruce prays. I pray before I start. Lord, send your Holy Spirit. Help us. Teach us. But is the Holy Spirit going to teach us anything? No. But he's also going to bring all things to our remembrance. Remember, I was talking a moment ago about you're getting ready to do something that you know doesn't go with the Word of God. All of a sudden, you might have a certain scripture pop in your mind. That's the Holy Spirit bringing that to your remembrance. You know, how are you with your Bible memory? Remember we talked about the Waldensians the other night, you know? And I'm not all that good with my scripture memory. I'm not. But one thing that's a blessing for me, and maybe you've experienced this too, when you're in the midst of sharing Jesus, all of a sudden a verse comes to you, and then another verse, and another verse. And you know that just in a casual conversation, you couldn't bring that to your own remembrance. You couldn't call that up to memory. But you know what's happening? It's the Holy Spirit bringing things to your remembrance. But you got to first put it in your mind for the Holy Spirit to pull it out of your memory bank. That's called Bible study. But notice, it's not just going to be anything that's going to come to your mind. It's going to be whatever Jesus said first. So the Holy Spirit glorifies what Jesus said. This is what I base that statement I said earlier on. The Holy Spirit is not going to teach us anything contrary to the testimony of Jesus. It's going to be in harmony. This is why, and I'll bring it up in a minute. I'll talk about it. I don't want to talk about it yet. The Holy Spirit instructs us in the principles of God's Word. And that's a good thing, amen? You know why it's a good thing? Because if it's not the Holy Spirit instructing us, who's doing the instructing? Can we instruct ourselves? Can I sit there and say, okay, this is what I'm going to determine what is right in my life and what's wrong in my life. This is what I'm going to determine the basis of salvation. You know, not using this as my guideline, but just my own self. Look what the Bible says in Jeremiah 17, 9 and 10. The heart, my heart, Ron Foutz's heart, is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? See, praise the Lord, we have the Holy Spirit to give us instruction. I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins. Jesus is saying here through Jeremiah that we should not depend on our own reasoning. There's a story in Genesis chapter 3 of a lady relying on the wickedness of her own. Well, I shouldn't say wickedness, but she was relying on her own reasoning. I'll say it that way. And that was before sin entered in. And how strong, how good was her reasoning without sin? Oh, it looks good for food. How much weaker are we in our hearts? We don't even know our own hearts. Praise God, He does know our hearts. He searches our hearts. He says, my son, my daughter, I know what's best. Father knows best. Trust me. Follow my word. He tries the reins. He knows what's best. It's good. It's a good thing that the Holy Spirit is the one that's doing the instructing. It's good for us to listen to His instruction. Not too good if we ignore Him. Proverbs 16:25, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man or a woman, but the end thereof are the ways of, praise God, we have the Holy Spirit to be our instructor. Amen? Okay. Can we trust ourselves? Can we trust each other in things? Now, we can again, encourage each other. I don't want to discourage of us encouraging each other. But when it comes to salvational things, if you go to anybody, I don't care who it is, if you go to anybody and you, with any kind of personal issue or personal problem, if that person does not lead you to Jesus, run from that person. You with me? Because there's a way that seemeth right unto human reasoning, but the end of human reasoning are the ways of death. Jesus tells us in John 16, verse 13, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself. He won't speak of himself. Why? He's only going to share that which what Jesus has already shared. He will not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and show you things to come. So it's the Holy, I want to start here and work my way backwards in these verses, or in this verse. It's the Holy Spirit that reveals the prophecies, the things to come. But he's only going to share what he hears. Who do you think the Holy Spirit is hearing the word from? Jesus said it in chapter 14, those things which Jesus has already spoken. The Holy Spirit will not contradict Jesus. But it said, let me back it up, that he will guide us into all truth. Chapter 14, he's teaching us the truth. Chapter 16, he's guiding us into that truth. In other words, when he teaches us the truth, that's hearing the word. But he doesn't want us to be hearers only. He wants us to be doers. That's guiding us into the truth. He wants us to live that truth. Not hearers only, but doers of the word shall be justified before God. It is the same Holy Spirit that moved holy men to write the truth in the scriptures that wants to lead us into that same truth. Did you follow that thought? The same Holy Spirit that inspired Isaiah, the same Holy Spirit that inspired Daniel, the same Holy Spirit that inspired Moses to write, in the beginning God created heaven and the earth, that Holy Spirit, is the same Holy Spirit speaking to us tonight through the Word. It's the same Holy Spirit that wants to teach us truth. It's the same Holy Spirit in our life today that wants to guide us into that truth. He doesn't change. Amen? The Holy Spirit leads us into truth. Okay, now I'm going to take a mouthful of water and we're going to shift gears just slightly. I'm going to give a couple of theological phrases, a couple of theological terms, and explain them to help us to see what sin is, to be able to recognize it, because we'd be good to recognize it in our life, right? In order to be able to deal with it. And thinking, when Moses and the children of Israel left Egypt, where was the first place they went after they crossed that Red Sea? They went to Mount Sinai because God said, I got to show you what sin is in your life so you can deal with it. And then he gave them the provisions to deal with it called the sanctuary. So he's given us provision, his name's Jesus, through confession and repentance. But we need to know what to confess and repent, right? So it'd be a good thing to see what sin is. So the first sin I want to look at is called the sin of commission. Sin of commission, very simple, it's not difficult at all, is when you commit sin. When you break the Ten Commandments, you're committing sin. So you commit the sin, and then Jesus will, the Holy Spirit, I'll say it that way, the Holy Spirit will show you, okay, you committed the sin. Now, if you confess the sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all that unrighteousness, but go and sin no more, right? Now, once he says, go and sin no more, and you choose to go against the word of God and go sin again, that's another type of sin. That's called the sin of omission. You know to do right, but you omit to do it. Two different types of sin there. James chapter 4, verse 17 tells us, therefore to him that knoweth to do good and doeth not, to him that is sin. So you have the sin of commission, transgression against the law. It was all transgression against all law. I mean, everything falls in that category. But you have the committing of sin. Then you have the omittance of doing that which is right in the sight of God that you know better. Now, which sin is more deadly? They're all the same. Any sin separates from God. The honest person is willing to alter their ideas to fit the truth. Isn't that so? That's called going to God with a teachable attitude, like a noble Berean. You go to the Word of God and say, Lord, show me what you want me to see of myself that you see, that I need to deal with. But be willing to do that. Be willing to alter your beliefs, your lifestyle. Alter anything that is unbiblical in your life. Be willing to alter that. That's growing closer to Christ in grace. The honest person is willing to alter their ideas to fit the truth. The dishonest person wants to alter the truth to fit their ideas, twisting the scripture to make it fit what you want it to fit. That's not rightly dividing the Word of God. That's a private interpretation when you do that. There's danger in that. So what about feeling convicted of truth? I've heard that many, many times. I see it in the Bible, Ron, but I'm just not convicted on that yet. Excuse me. Now, let me just make this statement. Wouldn't that be a lack of faith in God's Word? I don't feel convicted on it. You know, think of a little, you have Johnny. Johnny's an adult. He's out there on the highway, right? And why Johnny's out there on the highway, I don't know. Maybe he just had a bad morning. And he's facing down the road this way, and you see behind him is coming a big old Mack truck, right? And you yell out, Johnny, look out, a truck's coming. And he's standing there. I mean, I don't feel the urgency. I don't feel the danger. Did his lack of conviction change the truth of that truck coming up on him? How many times does God have his truth of the Bible shared with people? I see it in the Bible. But I need to go home and pray about it and see what the Holy Spirit says about it. I'm not convicted on it yet. I got to go home and pray about it. Well, here's something I want to share with everybody. If you see it in the Word of God, that is the Holy Spirit saying it. It's not you having to go wait on the Holy Spirit to teach you. The Holy Spirit already taught you. The Holy Spirit is waiting on you to move. There's no, I don't feel convicted over it when you read it from the Word of God. You walk by faith, not by sight, not by your feelings. You see it in the Word of God. If God says it, do it. Does it mean it's easy to do? Yes and no. If you try to do it without the Holy Spirit, it's impossible. But if you submit yourselves to God, truthfully and honestly to our Creator, if you love me, do it for the right reason. And if you don't think you're doing it for the right reason, pray for God to give you the right reason. He'll place that in your heart. Then he'll give you the Holy Spirit. And with the Holy Spirit, the power. 2 Timothy 3:7 talks about a sad event of people who are coming to seminars year after year, coming to Bible studies week after week, and they just don't seem to be able to get it. Forever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Why? Somewhere they're shutting the system down. Somewhere in their life they're shutting it down. They're seeing it, they're reading it and everything, but there's something in their life that the Holy Spirit has showed them in the past. And they may have forgot about it. It may have been a long time. But there's something in the Word of God that the Holy Spirit revealed to them that is in their life that they need to do away with because it's not a good thing for them. And they have said no to it. But yet, they don't want to let go of it. They may not necessarily have committed it as the unpardonable sin, the last brick yet. But until they deal with that, they're not going to have the deeper understanding. Because God's saying, you're not living up to the light I gave you. Trust you with more light. Right? So this group of people here that Paul's writing to Timothy about is talking about they're always learning, but they're not able to get there. They're missing a part of the process, and that's the submission part. Father, I see it. I don't understand it, but I see it, and I know that you're talking to me. Goes against everything I believe. Goes against every desire I have, but I see it's your truth. I need to make this change in my life. And then follow through with it. And then the Holy Spirit would grow and grow. You know, and I think I showed this picture earlier in the seminar. Just imagine for a moment that you were just resurrected. And it's the end of the 1,000 years. And you're standing in the crowd. Jerusalem's over there. It's not around you. It's over there. And that's the view you have. You think you would be convicted then of God's truth? The only problem is it's too late. Everybody's going to have that conviction finally. Every knee's going to bow. Every tongue's going to confess. Blessed are they that do his commandments. Those that are outside of New Jerusalem are going to be totally convicted then that that's truth. Only it's too late for them. Don't be in that crowd. Amen? Don't make the decisions in this life not to be in that crowd. Jesus says in John 7, verses 43 through 48, so there was a division, or the John says, so there was a division among the people because of Jesus. And some of them would have taken him, but no man laid hands on him. Then came the officers to the chief priests and Pharisees, and they said unto them, why have you not brought him? Why did you not snag Jesus and bring him to us? And the officers answered, never man spake like this man. Here you had the church leaders, the rulers, telling their officers, go get that guy. Go get that truth. Bring that truth back to us. We need to deal with that truth. We don't want that truth exposed anymore. And when these people, their intent was to go do something bad with Jesus. But the Holy Spirit pricked these officers' hearts as they heard truth being spoken. And they did not harden their hearts to that pricking. They listened. They were edified by it. And they did not do what they were told to go do. They honored Jesus. And they went back to this guy. Then answered them the Pharisees, are you deceived? Have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed on him? Why would you, who is nothing, believe in something that we don't believe in? You see the danger in that? Study for yourself. Don't trust me. Don't trust anybody in any position when it comes to Bible study. We can help each other. Again, I got to go back to that. We can help and encourage each other with a deeper understanding. But you better be testing everything everybody tells you to the Bible for yourself. I am positive, and I can't base this on anything, but I'm positive in my own mind that when Noah was preaching for 120 years, somebody who did not get on that boat was convicted. That means they must have hardened their heart. Why? Well, maybe because they don't see the sheriff getting on board, or they didn't see the governor getting on board. Or maybe their parents didn't get on board. Or their children didn't want to go. Something held them back. Salvation is a very, very, very personal choice. Very personal decision. It's between the individual and Jesus. You with me on that? Amen? And it's through the Holy Spirit that God does the working. Luke 16, 31. And he said unto them, him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. What's Jesus telling us in this parable here in Luke? He's saying, if they wouldn't listen to Moses and the prophets. I find it interesting when Jesus was resurrected, and you have the two that were on the road to Emmaus. Then somebody showed up with them and walked along with them, right? And then that person went on with those two home, and they had a meal. And then they realized who that person was. Who was that person? And that was Jesus. And then Jesus, from far as I know in the Bible, Jesus held his first Bible, you know, the Bible study that he actually led out in with Scripture. And he showed the two from that walk all that was prophesied about Jesus in the writings of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms. So when Jesus, and that's the Old Testament. So when Jesus is saying, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, what he's referring to is if they don't pay attention what I gave in my word, that's what Jesus is saying, they won't pay attention to any miracle. Though one rose from the dead. If they don't accept Jesus for his word, nothing's going to convince them. Not any miracle, not any sign. If a person is basing their faith on miracles, Jesus says, if you're going to do that, I'm not going to give you a miracle to base your faith on. But I'll share this with you. If we're looking for a miracle to base our faith, Satan has one waiting for us. And how do I know Jesus won't do it? This is an evil generation. They seek a sign, and there shall no sign be given it. Jesus will not send a miracle. I had a friend who was preaching in Pennsylvania. I don't know if I shared this story in this seminar yet or not, but I'll share it again because this is the perfect place for it. My friend was preaching in Pennsylvania, and he was preaching night 9 of the seminar. He has the same seminar, and he was preaching about the seventh-day Sabbath. And he was preaching it, and then he had people in the crowd that was hearing it for the first time, and they were being brought under conviction by the Holy Spirit, and they went home that night. And then the next night, when they were doing history's greatest religious cover-up, when they looked at those 8 places in the New Testament talking about the first day of the week, this particular gentleman came up to him and said, Brian, yeah, I never heard that before last night, but I got to share with you what happened last night. On the way home, I'm walking home. I said, Lord, I've never seen that in the Bible before. If that's your truth, send a shooting star. This is a true story. The guy goes, wow, must be true. 7 days is the Sabbath. Now, he learned it from the Bible the night before. He's walking home, and of course, the doubt rises up. Lord, if that really is, send another one. Now, I don't know if those are from God or not. He walked a little bit farther. Lord, I've never seen 3 in one night. He shared this with Brian. By the end of the seminar, that guy rejected the seventh-day Sabbath and did not complete the seminar. You see it from the Word of God, but you let your feelings, your senses overrule. It's very dangerous. The best time to do God's will is when you know what it is from the Bible and allow that Holy Spirit to bring that into your life. Let Him guide you into that truth and do it in His strength and don't seek a sign, because Jesus says if you're going to base your faith on any kind of miracle, you may get a miracle, but it's not going to be from heaven. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. And I think I'm only reading 9 through 10. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders. See, the devil has miracles waiting for us. But I want to point something out here before I continue with this. Even him whose coming is after. Now, that's not talking about timing. It's not talking about there wasn't anybody coming before that hand. This is talking about character. You've heard it. He takes after his dad. Yeah, it's not talking in that context about him being born after his dad, even though he was. He's talking about character. So this is talking about even those people who have the character of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the what? They don't fall in love with Jesus enough to keep his commandments. But it's also the Spirit of truth, the Holy Spirit. They're not allowing the Holy Spirit to guide them into the truth that has been exposed to them through God's Word. And that is a very dangerous thing. John 3:19 says, and this is the condemnation. Oh, let me back up, because I want to make a connection between these two verses here. Now, I know I said this in the seminar, But what we get from these verses here, this is the one I'm going to click again, is that nobody's going to burn up in hellfire for filing error. Everyone burning in hellfire will be burned up because truth came and they didn't fall in love with it enough to keep it. They rejected it. They said no to the Holy Spirit. No, I don't want to be guided in that. Over and over, and all those bricks went up. Every person lost is going to be because they rejected light. It says in John 3:19, and this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love the darkness rather than light because their deeds were evil. When the light comes, walk ye in it. Amen? But people choose to trample underfoot God's Ten Commandments. How do they trample it underfoot? Oh, we don't keep that seventh-day Sabbath, that Jewish day. We're New Testament Christians. We keep that first day. One way. Another way is, oh, they're nailed to the cross. Another way is taking out the second commandment completely. You know, now think about it. If the law of God could be changed, the law of God, which is his transcript of his character, if it could be changed in any way, don't you think that God might have changed it before he had experienced that? The cross is the ultimate evidence that the Ten Commandments still stand. To be 90% saved is to be 100% lost. James says that if you break one, you're guilty of all. If you break one, there's how many? There's 10. If you break one, that's 90% saved. But, you know, Jesus also said, and do all those things that are pleasing in his sight. So that makes that 90% even higher. What if we were 99.999% saved? Would that still be 100% lost? You better believe it would. 1 Samuel 15, verse 3 says, this is Samuel talking to King Saul. King Saul, when he was made king, was filled with the Holy Spirit. He prophesied, it says in the Bible. And then he started going, falling back away from the prompting of God in his life. And God had a test for him. See, he says here, now go and smite Amalek. And the Amalekites, it said, destroy all that they have. This is talking about the Amalekites. Now, God has not chosen a group of people just to destroy, to test somebody. That group of people had their cup filled. God already determined. That whole group has already passed that unpardonable sin mark. But he's going to test Saul by using Saul as the instrument of judgment to the Amalekites. So let's make that clear. Now go, this is Samuel talking to Saul. Now go, Saul, and smite Amalek, and utterly destroy all that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox, sheep, camel, and ass. Everything. Even the children? Now, if I was Saul, and I had God's prophet tell me to go kill kids, infants, I would be tempted to reason in my heart. Would you? Father Abraham, take your son, thy only son, who you know your salvation is going to come through his seed. Take him to a mountain, I'll show you, and offer him up as a sacrifice. Did Abraham question God and say, wait a minute. God, my salvation is through this child. No, he had faith in the Word of God. He said, God, I really don't understand, but your purpose is something higher than my understanding. And if you need to, you'll resurrect my son. The Bible reveals that Abraham's thinking that. So Saul was sent to go do this. Now, God knows what's best. He knows the beginning from the end when it comes to these infants. I still don't understand it. That may be a good question to ask God when we get to heaven. You know, let me see why the kids. I want to have a deeper understanding. Maybe. But did Saul do that? Does Saul follow the instruction of the Lord? He reasoned in his mind. You know, why should we kill other animals? What do their animals do? You know? And, you know, we have their animals, and let's not kill them. We can use their animals maybe for food, and we have our animals that we'll use for our sacrificing, or vice versa. Well, it's such a waste. I mean, I can imagine King Saul's having that go through his mind. And then the king, Amalek, you know, he's more valuable to me alive. Maybe I won't kill him either. Maybe I can use him in a way to help glorify God. See, this is reasoning. But our hearts are desperately wicked above all things, right? And our thinking, our ways end up death. You with me? And Samuel came to Saul. And Saul said unto him, Blessed be the Lord, thou the Lord. I have performed the commandment of God. So Saul went to do his task. And as he's coming back, the prophet meets up with him. Oh, here comes the Holy Spirit's conviction. You ever notice that in your life? Holy Spirit has prompted you to do something, and you go against it. And as soon as you go against it, maybe you get a phone call, or maybe you're feeling guilty, and you pick up the Bible, and you open right to the verse that's hitting you right here. See, that's the prophet coming to Saul. Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said unto him, Hey, man, I did it. Did he? No. Samuel says, Well, if you've killed all the animals, why do I hear the bleeping of sheep? And the king's still there. And Samuel had said, Hath the Lord his great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifice, as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. You know what that was for King Saul, that event right there? It was that last brick. From that point on, the Holy Spirit was withdrawn. Read it. His life was miserable after that. The devil was just giving him thoughts, and he would follow through with those thoughts. He failed to allow the Holy Spirit to lead him in the ways of God. And it didn't make sense to Saul. Kill the kids? Kill the animals? But to obey. Obedience is the highest form of worship. Read Romans chapter 6. I don't think I have it on the screen. I think it's verse 16. Who you yield yourselves servants to obey, to him that you obey, you're his servant. Obedience is the highest form of worship, whether it's worshiping the Creator or the beast power. 1 John 2:3 says, And hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. Verse 4. And he that saith, I know him, keep not his commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. Wasn't that the very experience of King Saul? All the Lord commanded I have done. No, you haven't. You're lying. Acts 5:29, then Peter and the other apostles answered, said, We ought to obey God rather than men. Love always leads to obedience. If you love me, Jesus says, keep my commandments, and then you'll receive the power of the Holy Spirit to be witnesses unto me as my ambassadors. Jesus always leads to obedience. Proverbs 4, verse 18 says, But the path of the just is as the shining light that shineth more and more unto the perfect day. That light is the truth that comes into our life. We receive the light. We receive the truth. We honor God by allowing the Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us into that, into our lives, make that part of our character. Then he brings more light, more truth. It's rewarding us with a deeper, deeper understanding of God's way. And in the meantime, we're blessed because we're growing closer to Christ in character. That's growing in grace. Step by step by step by step. And we do that. And the only way that we can do that is through prayerful Bible study to know what His will is. What are these things, Lord? Take your Bibles, open to Acts chapter 18. I don't have a page number. You should know where Acts is. Acts chapter 18. I want to read a few verses here. I want to show you something. Because a lot of people, they sometimes get upset because they may be a church leader. They may be a teacher at church or they may be an evangelist, or whatever position they may be a deacon. You know, I don't need to learn more. I know what the Bible says. I'm in this exalted position. But the Bible says something different. So we're going to look at Acts chapter 18. I'm going to start in verse 24. I have it on the screen, but I don't have the other verses on the screen. I want to show you what the Bible says about something. It's a really good principle for all of us. It says, is everybody there say amen? And a certain Jew named Apollos, born at Alexandria, That's one, eloquent man, and mighty, that's two, mighty in the scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man was, three, instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent, that's four, fervent in the spirit, he spake and taught diligently, that's five, the things of the Lord, not only the baptism of John. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, that's six. Six fantastic things I would love God's word to say about me. How about you? And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more. Folks, learning of God, learning of Jesus never has an end. No matter where we are, God wants that light to shine more perfect in every experience based on the Bible that we have. He wants to give us more truth and more truth. His truth is non-exhaustive. I've read it once that throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity, the plan of salvation is going to be our study. We will never, throughout eternity, have a complete grasp on the plan of salvation. We're never above learning of God. Amen? We should all be sponges. And it's the Holy Spirit that wants to teach us the truth. And if we choose to shut the Holy Spirit down in any which way, you see the point I'm making? So what is the one sin that cannot be forgiven? Matthew 12, 32. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, Jesus says, it shall not be forgiven. Okay, what is the sin against the Holy Spirit? Answer, the sin against the Holy Spirit is our deliberate and final refusal to permit him to do for us what Jesus sent him to do. And what did Jesus send the Holy Spirit to do for us? To teach us and to guide us into all truth. Take your Bibles, open up to Hebrews. Hebrews, we'll go to chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. We'll just look at this one verse in Hebrews. When you get to chapter 10, say amen. Now, I still don't know if that was everybody. I don't know why I say that. Hebrews chapter 10, I'm going to read verse 26. For if we sin willfully, that would be deliberate. That would be you know better, but you do it anyway. You're saying no to God. If we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, so you know better. There remaineth how much sacrifice? None. Now, that's not a one-time deal. And I pray I have not been putting that across tonight. It's a process. It's that brick after brick after brick after brick after brick. What that Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26 is sharing there is the last brick. If you keep doing this and you harden your heart and you keep saying no to what you know is in the Bible, when you get to that unpardonable sin line and you cross it, Jesus says, my blood just can't cover that. I'm withdrawing my Holy Spirit, whom I sent to teach you and guide you into the truth, that you have consistently rejected that truth. So why share the truth anymore? John 16, 8, Jesus says, and this is the verse we started with tonight. Now I want to expound on it after we went through all that. And when he, the Holy Spirit, has come, he will reprove the world of. See, the job of the Holy Spirit is to show us the sin in our lives. This is where your character does not square up with the Bible. This is where you are not in harmony in your life with the Word of God. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It's going to show us what the sin is in your life. Remember, there's two types of sin, basically. The sin of commission, which is this right here. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is transgression of law. That's the sin of commission. Then you have the sin of omission. You're omitting to do that which you know to be right. But look in Psalm 19, verse 13. David says, Lord, keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sin. What is presumptuous sin? That's a very dangerous sin. That's the sin. It's like, I see it here, and I know I'm not living that. Gotta understand with me, that's presumption. That's iniquity. That's willful sin. That's what we read in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. If you do it willfully, knowing that is not right, David's saying that's presumptuous sin. Let them not have dominion. Let what not? Let not the presumptuous sin have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent of the great transgression. That's the dangerous one. Presumptuous sin is where we reason it in our mind that it's okay. We say no so much to God, to His Holy Spirit prompts us, that we get to the point where we just don't feel like it's wrong anymore, and it just becomes part of who we are. We're just presuming it's okay. It feels all right. I don't see anything wrong with it anymore. John 16, 13, the Spirit of truth will guide you into that truth. At any point, we can choose to shut that process down, and that's dangerous when we do that. So once He shows us the sin, He's going to reprove the world or convict the sin or convince the world of sin, showing the sin. Then He's going to show us righteousness. Now I showed you the wrong way. Think of Moses when children of Israel came out. They went and got the Ten Commandments. They got the knowledge of sin. And then God said, now I have the remedy, the way of righteousness, the sanctuary. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So that was the way of righteousness. Thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. So He shows us what's wrong, and He says, okay, now I will show you how to walk the righteous path. And then we have a choice. We don't have to go that way, but He shows us the remedy to the sin, the righteous way. Amen? And why is that important? Because that's the decisions that we're going to be judged by. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He shows us the wrongs in our lives. He shows us how to correct that, gives us the power to do the correction. And He says, you're going to be judged by the decisions you make. If we pass the judgment, we haven't grieved the Holy Spirit, and He seals us unto redemption. Amen? If we grieve the Holy Spirit, do we receive the seal of God? Folks, that's judgment. One way to look at it. But look what it says here. Because sentence, this is Ecclesiastes 8:11. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is full set in them that do evil. Let me rephrase this. Well, I committed a sin yesterday, and I haven't been punished yet. I'm getting away with it. You see, we get comfortable in our sin, because we're not being executed quickly. Can you imagine if God was to execute His judgment on us immediately? How many people would be on this planet? It'd be an empty planet, wouldn't it? He's long-suffering and merciful. Praise God for that. Yet the devil will take that long-suffering and mercy of God and twist it around and cause people to reason in their mind that to make them comfortable where they're at in their walk with the Lord. I don't see what's wrong. It hasn't hardened me yet. That's presumptuous sin. That's what the devil will do with that. But there is that judgment. There is the calling to the judgment. But who's the judge? Jesus. Who's our advocate? Amen? Amen. Jesus says in Matthew 10, verse 32, whosoever therefore shall confess me before men, him will I confess also before my Father which is in heaven. This my Father, this child here lived their lives according to my will to the best of their ability, the best that I was able to, you know, my power and strength was to do for them. I don't know if that came out right. But they confessed. They lived according to my will. My blood covers them. That's Jesus confessing us before the Father. See, we're sinful. We have nothing in us but filthy rags. It's only through the blood of Christ. And the only way that we pass that judgment is if Christ stands in our place. That's what this is talking about. But you mean I have to confess people, confess Jesus to other people? I got a witness? My family, my friends, my coworkers, they might belittle me. Really? They might make fun of me. You know, back in the days when I was in the band, I would take that needle filled up with cocaine and jam it in my vein. My friends didn't really seem to care. They said, give me some. Get in the car, drive down the road 120 miles an hour. My friends didn't care. They wanted to go with me. The moment that I picked this up and wanted to change my life into this, all of a sudden my friends had all kinds of advice for me. Have you experienced that in your life? Something similar to that? We should be witnessing ambassadors, dutiful, faithful ambassadors for Jesus Christ. When we do that, God will bless us. He says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. And they'll come falsely, believe me. For my sake, for Jesus' sake. See, we can do things and make choices in our own lives that would bring these kind of accusations that does not glorify God. That's on us. If we make a stand for Jesus, we're confessing Jesus in our lives by the decisions we make, by allowing the Holy Spirit to teach us and guide us into these truths, no matter what those truths are in the Bible. And we're allowing that to take place. Then this, if this results from that, for Jesus' sake, here's the blessing. Rejoice and be exceeding glad. For great is your reward where? May not be in this life. But remember, Jesus will confess us to the Father. That's in heaven. Your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. How are you with your growing in grace? How are you with your Bible studies? Are you digging into the Bible with the prayerful attitude, Lord, reveal from your word something in my life I need to deal with? Something in your word that you can reveal to me that I can glorify you by allowing your Holy Spirit to lead me into that. Are we praying that? Wouldn't that be praying for a character development? Wouldn't that be praying for Christ's mind to be in us? Revelation 2:7 says, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the church. Are your ears opened up tonight? I like that picture. So what's the Spirit saying to us tonight? To him that overcome what? The increased price of gas? Overcome the sin in our life. That's right. Overcoming the things that our characters don't square up with what God has revealed in His Word. Overcoming all of that. To him and her that allows the Holy Spirit, to him and her that allow Jesus to finish the work that he began in us through his Holy Spirit, will I give to eat of the tree of life. Boy, there's a condition. Salvation's free, but it does have some biblical conditions. The tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise. Okay, so what are those big ears listening to? They're perked up to hear Jesus. My sheep, Jesus says, hear my voice. See, it's through the Holy Spirit. Jesus is not physically his voice. It's his Holy Spirit is speaking to our hearts. And I know them. And they do what? They're allowing the Holy Spirit to guide them into the truth that Jesus has revealed in his word. That's what the Holy Spirit is to do. 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, behold, now is the accepted time. behold, now is the day of salvation. Everywhere in Scripture, Jesus, God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Godhead, puts it into the present tense. Do it now. Satan says, nah, just do it tomorrow. You don't have to do it now. You had plans for tonight. Something that's not squaring up with the Bible. Or you have plans for tomorrow. Something that's not squaring up to the Bible. Something that does not glorify God. You have plans for that. So do this after that. See, that's Satan's will. Is there danger in that? Follow the light when it's shining on you. Romans 8:14. For as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons and daughters of God. They haven't said no to the Holy Spirit. Jesus, he was in the garden at night 2,000 years ago. He knew what he was supposed to do for salvation of us. He knew what was about to take place. He chose three of his apostles, and they went to a corner of the garden to pray. And he said, wait here, and I'm going over here. Pray for me, watch and pray, and I'm going over here. And he went over there, and what did his disciples do? Fell asleep. Jesus was in agony, pleading with the Father. Then he came back and woke him up, right? And then he said, well, okay, pray and watch. I'm going back over here. So he went up. Jesus was in such agony. Oh, Father, not my will, but thy will be done. So much. He was sweating, wasn't he? What was he sweating? His capillaries were bursting. He was in such agony and stress as he was purposing in his heart that he was going to go. Did he have to go through with the cross? Would it have been a sin for Jesus if he would have said no to the cross? It would not have been a sin for him. He didn't have to die. He was without sin. We would be lost. But he had the right to do that. But he was sweating. Such stress. How is it with you? How is it with me? This is the question I'm asking myself. When a temptation comes up to me, and that temptation could be something to commit sin or to omit to do that which I know is right in the sight of God, something that the Bible says, give it up. And I am tempted to go my way. Am I getting on my knees and struggling with that as Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane to the point where I am sweating blood? Look what Paul says in Hebrews 12:4. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. Huh? We have a striving to do, folks. That striving is to follow and allow the Holy Spirit to work in our hearts. Psalm 51, as we come to a close. I put brackets there. Put your name. I'm going to read it out loud with my name. You read it in your mind and place your name in the brackets. Okay? Create in Ron a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit in me, Ron. Create in me a clean heart. I need a cleaner heart, Lord. My heart's dirty. It's filled with pride, desire for the things of this world. Create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within me, Lord. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not the Holy Spirit from me. Don't let me commit that presumption sin. Don't let that Holy Spirit be taken away. Don't allow me to commit the unpardonable sin. Lord, change my heart, please. My heart is desperately wicked above all things. Create in me a right spirit. Fear thou not, Jesus tells us through the prophet Isaiah. Fear thee not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen you, amen? I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Bible's filled with promises. The promises, he will do that work in us if we allow him. And he'll guide us in that truth with his strength. It's not our strength. All we do is say yes. Amen? Say yes. Can you say yes? Say yes. Jesus says, come unto me. Now I'm going to ask the men to come up very quickly, and they're going to put another card in your hand with a pencil. We have pencils also. And we got to get that done quickly because we're getting a little late tonight, Craig. And we're going to walk through this card one more time. And again, this is the decision between you and Jesus. And when you get your card, out of courtesy to me as your speaker, if you would put your name there at the bottom, I'd appreciate that. But this is your decision. And again, these decision cards, the purpose of these decision cards is to help us to get into the habit of saying yes to Jesus. Saying no to that which is not good for us and saying yes to that which is good for us from God. And I pray that that habit would grow into our personal lives more and more. So we have that. Go ahead and write your name at the bottom there, please. Whoever does not have a card or a write-in utensil, raise your hand. Okay, let's get going. Number one there, I do not want to commit that unpardonable sin. I do not want to put that last brick in the wall. I don't even want to put the first brick in the wall. If that's your decision or desire, put a check in that box. And boy, I pray I see a check in all those boxes. I know the Lord is praying that he will see checks going in that box. We don't want to commit that. We want the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us into all truth. The second one there is I surrender to the Holy Spirit and commit my life to Jesus 100% above family, friends, churches, or anything else in our lives. Jesus is number one. That should be our priorities. Amen? Amen. So I pray that there's checks in all those boxes. Third one is I thank God for his Spirit leading me and now desire to become part of his remnant church. If you haven't had the opportunity to be baptized to become a Seventh-day Adventist, and that's your desire to become part of the remnant church, put a check there and we'll work towards having that accomplished in the near future. So I want to encourage if those that are not members of the church to check that. To become a member of the Seventh-day Adventist church, that is through baptism. And if you would like a personal visit from myself or the pastor or the elder or a combination of the three, then go ahead and check that last box there as well and place your phone number there. The unpardonable sin is a very, very serious subject, but also, and I got a little bit passionate with it tonight, but also it's a wonderful study because it's a study of the third of the Godhead, the Holy Spirit. And it's wonderful to see how God works in our hearts to understand the workings of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Then you start recognizing it more and more, and it's a blessing. Amen? It is. It really is. Anyway, as you finish writing that, go ahead and turn your cards over and hand them down the aisle to the center of the church, and Craig will come up quickly to pick them up, and Craig will bring them up here and place them on the table here. Jesus says, come unto me if you are heavily burdened. If you have so much cares of this life, go to Jesus. Yoke up with Jesus. He says, my burden's light and easy. It's his strength that we do it. You yoke up, that means you're walking with Jesus. You yoke up with Jesus, that means he's got the strength. He's the power. So we'll go ahead and we'll stand as we have our closing prayer at this time. Thank you, Craig. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. And we'll be back again tomorrow morning for overcoming temptation through the Word. And we'll see the mechanics from the Bible of how the Holy Spirit wants to guide us into that truth. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, Lord, we're so thankful and grateful for this Sabbath evening. We're thankful for this holy day that we can worship you in spirit and truth. And we pray, Lord, for your help as we worship you, that it be pleasing in your sight. Lord, we're so thankful that you sent the Holy Spirit to be with us, to be in us, Lord, to teach us, to guide us into that truth, Lord. And we just pray as we are growing in grace that your Holy Spirit will fill us more and more until we're becoming so much like Jesus that we'll be with Jesus. So we pray now as you dismiss us. We pray for travel and mercies. Take us to our homes safely, Lord. Bring us back in the morning safely, Lord, that we may continue to worship you on this day. That we may continue to open your word to see what your Holy Spirit wants to reveal to us next. And we do pray this and give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.